Welcome everyone to our event today, to our webinar. It's a total pleasure for me to be sharing some information with you. But before that, let me just tell you, let you know a little bit more about myself. So I'm a certified psychologist and coach. Throughout my professional background, I managed to try myself in different fields. So I've got a couple of years of teaching, a couple of years of actually content marketing, but after all, I found myself in HR and coaching field, and people is basically my passion, and it's my sincere belief that improving the quality of life, it's really an individual choice, and it's really up for a single person after he gets to know himself better. And that basically brings us to today's topic. So let me share my screen with you also. Okay, I hope everybody can see that. So today, as you all know, we will talk about stress management. And before we jump into the content itself, let us run a quick poll perhaps. And that would be about, the stress management and the signs that would help you to indicate that you are stressed. So for that, let me perhaps stop sharing for a while and let me start the poll. Right now, I think you can see that now on the screen. So basically, there are just a couple of questions, right? The first one is about the extent that you may experience if we talk about stress lately. And the second question is, how would you indicate that you are actually stressed? Let's take just several seconds on that.
Irina, is it sharing? Because I don't see it on my screen. Do people see the poll on their screen?
I think so.
Because yeah, okay, all good, good, okay.
I get the answers, so yeah, it's all right. Okay. Yep, I can see answers coming, so yeah, everything should be fine. That is just for us to see how stressed we are lately and what would help us to understand that we actually feel ourselves under pressure at some point. So yeah, I think just some more seconds and then we will continue. As I can see that the majority is already done. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think I will stop the poll for now. Let us see the answers. And well, I would say that at some point, we all feel ourselves under stress, which is definitely the issue that most likely brought us all here today. And emotional instability is something that would help you to indicate this, feeling stress, experiencing it. So let us then start the actual presentation of mine. Just a second. I'm sharing my screen with all of you now. Okay. So today we will cover a few topics, a few things that I would like to share with you. First of all, we will talk about what stress actually is, whether it has any advantages at all, and what are the cons of it. Then we will discuss the science of feeling stressed a little bit more, so that you perhaps become more self-aware of certain, you know, emotions, certain things that you experience, and you would also get to understand that those might be related to a certain stress level. After that, we will cover the techniques that would help you to lower stress. I believe that will be the most important part of our today's event. And I think as we are expecting more people to join us today, we will not really have get to the actual practice. However, I will share the actual exercises that you can do, either start doing already throughout our webinar or right after the event itself. And then, as Svetlana also mentioned, we will wrap up the webinar. So if there will be any questions, feel free to ask. So first things first, let's get to some statistics, to some numbers that would help us realize that stress is actually becoming an issue nowadays, since due to the researches, stress is a cause for emotional instability, increase in the anxiety level, and well, depression level at some point as well, unfortunately. But also, if we talk about the work-related things, then the absence rate is going up. Then sick leave is also going up, unfortunately, due to the fact that, and it's also been scientifically proven, that stress may cause physical changes that would lead us to some illnesses or just feeling sick. So in a long run, we may all become less productive, less emotionally stable, and well, also we would not be able to carry our responsibilities the same way as we did before, especially when it gets to the freelancers' point of view, as people who would actually be working on their own. So, are there any advantages at all about stress? Well, obviously there are, and let me share a couple of words about this aspect. So from the evolutionary point of view, stress is needed for our body to indicate the environment that can be potentially dangerous for us, and therefore to activate the fight or flight reaction. So in other words, in this environment, we would be ready to either attack the stressful factor or to avoid it and escape from this environment. So it's a measure of our body to basically protect ourselves. In the meantime, there are several changes that is happening from within. So first of all, it's an increase in newborn cells. And that basically leads us to increase of the productivity, concentration, to us being more attentive, and to respond to the changing environment in a faster way. So we may consider that, okay, perhaps stress is a good thing, right? And why do we ever want to get rid of it? However, we need to understand that stress should be experienced, and it will be actually useful for our body at a certain extent, so to a certain level. Because if we experience adrenaline or tension, or we feel ourselves under pressure at some point, and it's not a temporary thing, but it becomes permanent, then it would most likely lead us to nothing else but exhaustion and being unresourceful. So we would use all our resources to fight the factor, the stressful factor, but in the end, we would have no energy to get back to the usual level of productivity on our own. Apart from that, some people may experience irrational thinking when we are not able to make decisions with a clear head, with a clear mind. And obviously, being that uncertain would easily lead us to negative thoughts or you know, pessimistic feelings about the future, and also in more intense emotions that would distract us and leave us frustrated at some point. So to sum that part up, stress has its advantages, so it's not a 100% bad thing. However, and that is why our webinar is called stress management, right? We should not get rid of it entirely, and frankly speaking, we will not be able to, but we need to learn how to control that factor in our life. So moving forward, how do we actually realize that we are stressed? There are several factors, and we can take a look at it from different perspectives. So the first one is actually the emotional aspect that the majority of the respondents, they managed to indicate. So indeed, we may feel worried at all times. We may feel depressed, frustrated, irritated, and, you know, annoyed by certain things. And that obviously influences our daily mood, our interaction with other people, etc. Then we can get to the changes of the behavioral patterns. So there is a lack of motivation, and we do not see the point of carrying out the tasks the way we used to do. We would tend to isolate ourselves from others, and by that I mean from both people and other kinds of activities or tasks. And it can be especially essential if we talk about freelancers, right, who control their own workload and obviously feeling, experiencing that change in the behavioral pattern may lead to certain consequences. Cognitive changes, that is something that can also happen. So memory problems, when you do not remember what was happening yesterday, or you're on this autopilot throughout the day, and you do not, you know, you just carry on tasks without being actually involved into the process. So there is this lack of self-awareness there. Inability to concentrate, inability to make decisions. So there is this poor judgment aspect coming up here. And obviously, after some time, we may get to the physical changes that, as I mentioned earlier. So headaches or pain in certain parts of our body, or rapid heartbeat, increase in the pulse, and all other things that would also influence our perception of the world. If we get to the indicators of stress at work, right? So if we switch to professional life, once again, as I mentioned, we tend to work less, so to escape from tasks. If we talk freelancer's language, then we tend to take less projects, or let's say easier projects, so not the ones that we would be used to have. There is a tendency of having more conflicts with either clients or the people with whom you cooperate on certain tasks. And there is a tendency to either start working late, or you know, there is the shift in the working hours. So let's say if you're an early bird, then you get to start working later on because you cannot force yourself to start, and vice versa. So there are several things that would help you realize that, okay, something is actually wrong here, and that from my perception, that is the moment when you need to put a trigger there and realize that, okay, well, now it's a perfect timing for me to start reflecting, to start analyzing what has happened and actually deal with it. Okay. So let's get to the point of more practical side of things. Let's assume that we identified that, okay, we are stressed, we feel ourselves frustrated. What do we do with it anyway? And I'm going to introduce a few techniques that you can start actually doing either straight away or while I'm going to be explaining certain aspects. And we will start with more general recommendations and then get to something more narrow, let's say. So first things first, that's a digital detox. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the term. However, digital detox means minimizing the time of digital gadgets usage. That's one side of things. And from the other hand, limiting time of actually scrolling down the news feed or checking something in your laptop before you go to sleep. Once again, it was scientifically proven that usage of digital devices right before we go to bed, for example, that badly influence our sleeping patterns. So the quality of our sleep is much less than it used to be. That is one thing. And another recommendation of mine within this aspect would be to take care of the notifications that you have on your phone or in your laptop, in your computer, etc. I'm not sure, but perhaps some of you could face the situations when you want to recharge yourself a bit, you would like to take a break, get your head clear, and then get back to work. But then some notification pops up and there is a question from your client or some information from your colleague and you cannot do anything about it. You open up the app and you continue working once again. So there was no break after all, and you didn't have this opportunity to recharge. That is why either turning off notifications during the night hours might be a good idea, so that the first thing in the morning that you see is just your phone, but not the dozens of notifications there. And also sometimes you might consider turning off notifications during the weekends or just outside of your standard working hours that you define for yourself. So that would be one recommendation of it. Another one is about prioritizing. And it could not be more important once we talk about the freelancers. And myself also as a person who has a freelancer background, I can totally feel your pain when there is an overwhelming amount of tasks and projects, and it feels like everybody is expecting you to get done with everything at once. And that is a time when you, as the owner of your own processes, you need to take action and actually prioritize things. For that, the most logical one would be to come up with to-do lists. It can be done like really individually. Some people would feel comfortable creating a list of activities for the coming week. Some would feel comfortable with having 3 days planned ahead. Some people would find themselves really comfortable with having a cup of coffee in the morning and then creating a plan for today. But in any way, it would minimize the stress if there is less uncertainty, right? So perhaps you might feel less worried if you will see what lies ahead and what will be happening. Another part of it would be to understand what is actually there for you. In other words, should you be the person responsible for this task, or you can actually delegate it or discuss it with your client and see if you're actually responsible for it, or getting help, let's say hiring an assistant or asking your teammates who also work on the same project to help you out. But that also may help you to concentrate on only your core responsibilities. And another aspect here in the priorities would be to set the goal. Sometimes we may see that there are many things and you don't know where to start. And in this case, understanding of what is actually the most important thing here, what do I actually want to achieve by certain deadline, that would help you to see what is urgent and important here. So that would be the first priority for you in your list. Another recommendation would be to learn to say no. With that, I'm not saying that you should say no to every new project that you would like to get involved in, or to say no to every single request that you can be addressed with from your client or your colleague. But you need to understand that your work is what matters the most if we talk about professional life, and therefore helping out everybody else may actually lead you to run out of resources to carry on your own activities. That is why try to differentiate of something that, okay, you have time and you have energy to help somebody else, so you can actually jump into another thing for now, or you see that your workload is just enough for you to go for now, and that would be the perfect timing for you to learn and say no to other people. And once again, as I mentioned, try to differentiate between the I don't have to do it approach and I will not do it, right? Because then it comes to the interaction with other people, and it would be essential for you to say no, but then also to provide the arguments why that is happening so that your communication is not impacted anyhow. Another step, another recommendation to reduce stress would be to look at the big picture of what is going on now. Earlier today, I mentioned about the goal, but in our coaching practices, actually, we have a term that is called goal after goal. So you need to visualize and try to answer yourself a question. Okay, if let's say I achieve that goal of mine, what would it bring me? So what will actually happen afterwards? Will I really benefit from that? Or is it just something that I heard somebody setting this goal, so I just set it up for myself as well, and I'm not really interested in that? So you need to understand why you are doing things that you do and seeing the actual point of carrying these tasks would help you to minimize the stress, get this understanding, get the clarity and certainty in what you do. Another principle that I believe can really be applied to pretty much everything, even if we don't really talk about the professional life only, that is called a KISS principle that we also really welcome in our company at Translit, or it's also called keep it simple. So we believe that it's better to avoid getting things complicated, like complex and, you know, too difficult to comprehend and carry, if we can actually simplify everything and thus have a clear understanding of what is going on. So one aspect of KISS principle would be to find the balance, the work-life balance or life-work balance, as you can also put it, and get to understand yourself. So which ratio of work and life would be the most suitable for you? Would you feel like working 12 hours a day from Monday to Friday, but then having a rest during the whole weekend? Or would you feel actually comfortable of working until the midday and then also take some tasks during Saturday, like for Saturday and Sunday. You need to understand it for yourself, because no matter how many times you would Google the perfect ratio, it really gets to individuals afterwards. Another thing would be about organization. And that requires certain aspects of time management. I believe that freelancers would really get to that point somehow, because you need to plan your day and there is nobody to control you and tell you what to do. And then it's also about self-organization and self-discipline. So getting to work, even if you feel like being tired and you feel like, okay, but there is nothing out there who is controlling me. But then this self-discipline is also something that can help you to just plan your day and will keep the balance and yet keep things simple without being overwhelmed with tasks at some point. And obviously that would provide you a clear picture of your lifestyle nowadays, clear understanding of what is happening today, what will be happening tomorrow, and therefore the certainty of your workload. There are some other techniques, and some of those we can actually try already now. So it's getting more narrow at this point. The first one, the first technique to reduce stress is called the four A's, or avoid, alter, adapt, and accept. And those are the four aspects, the main four aspects that I will be covering from now on. So I believe the terms are pretty much obvious, but yet let's get to more details for each of that. So first, the avoid principle means that now it's time for you to also work on your self-awareness, look around, analyze when, in which environment would you feel stressed the most, so the most intensively, and try to understand, so try to find the cause of it, the source of stress. It can be the kids, let's say, if you work from home, and I believe that some of the people, they experienced that throughout the last month. It can be the music in the background of a coffee shop if you work from there and try to translate something. It can be the colleague of a client who's giving you some project, but then this colleague is constantly in touch with you and he's really requiring some details or some additional information or something like that, and you have no idea of, you know, how to deal with that. And you see no point of actually going through this kind of conversation and communication with this person. So it can be pretty much anything, starting from people and up for certain things that can get you irritated and worried about things. So the first recommendation here would be to find the source, to analyze how you can actually take control of it, and then either minimize it or ideally to get rid of it. So let's say if that is your working place, so the space that you arranged for work-related purposes, if that is the space that makes you stressed, perhaps you just need to change the environment at least for a couple of times and then see how that goes. So yeah, finding the resource, the source of stress, trying to minimize it or getting rid of it, that would be one thing. Another one would be about changing the attitude or alter principle. You can see here on the picture, it's a very classic case that comes when we talk about the attitude overall. So what would you see? Is glass half empty or half full, right? And then that was, well, stereotypically is a way that you can identify optimists or pessimists, right? Optimists would say that the glass is half full with water. Pessimists would say, well, no, it's actually half empty. Business-oriented people would actually say that it's 100% full, 50% with water, 50% with air. So you see the case, the environment is totally the same, but it really influences, like the way you perceive it really influences your following behavior and your attitude towards things. That is why changing perception is a really, I would say, the most powerful source that we may have in order to reduce stress or, well, get rid of it if we talk about certain factors. How to do that? That gets to the cognitive psychology. And the technique is called ABC technique. So basically there are three elements that are recognized as something that shapes our understanding of the surroundings and of the world generally. So A is the event. It can be a stressful event, it can be certain factor, it can be pretty much anything, but in terms of our webinar today, let's talk about stressful event only. B is our beliefs. So certain values, certain principles in our life, certain lessons that we managed to learn that would actually lead us to perceive this event and respond to that. And C would be the consequences. So the result of our reaction. The core point here is that it's not really the event itself that causes stress. It's really the way we perceive it and thus the way we respond to that. So essentially, you know, they always say that the more optimistic you look at the at things, the more optimistic they actually become. And now I hope you understand why, because it's indeed about the way you see things and the way you react to them. So instead of thinking outside of the box, you may actually try to change this box itself. Let's get to some practical example, okay? You may also in the meantime think of any other cases like that in your life. Perhaps there are some examples that happened recently with you. So let's say that there is a big interpreting event and you're invited there. So the client wants you to come and actually become a part of it. And once again, the workload is significant and you understand that there is a big amount of preparation that you need to do. And once again, it will be really time and energy consuming. So how you may perceive it? The way that would really welcome stress would be if you become worried and you think, all right, I have this event. It's really going to impact significantly on my reputation. It will really put a mark on my portfolio. So if I do anything wrong, I might really fail. I may really ruin my reputation at all. And well, once again, there can be something that can go wrong and I will not be able to fix it and et cetera, et cetera. So with these thoughts, with these attitudes, you're just going to end up feeling stressed and frustrated and, well, less concentrated on the actual event after all, right? You will be actually going through the emotions that you feel. However, how else we can take a look at it? We may feel excited, and that is actually another intense emotion that we may get confused stress with. Because excitement it also means anticipation of something, right? But then from a more positive side of things. So once again, if you look at the very same factor, you may feel like, all right, actually that is a great opportunity for myself to spread a word about my background, about my knowledge, about my competences. If something goes wrong, then all right, it's a chance for me to show how flexible I am, how I can easily adapt to the changing environment, because I actually have a significant background already, so I will be able to do that. I will be able to show people that, okay, here I am. I will be able to work on my network and build connections that I would really not be able to do, in any other way. So that is a great opportunity to promote myself after all. So you see, there is one factor, but depending on how you look at it, you may either look forward for it or really feel frustrated until the very point when the event will be finished. Okay, so that is the very simple, right, an easy technique, yet super fast. So hopefully you can also try it out after our today's event. However, sometimes it can happen that no matter how we change the attitude, things stay more pessimistic rather than positive. And even if we try and find every single potential and existing advantage of it, it still doesn't really help. So what to do in these cases? And in these cases, it's another principle that is about accepting. So accepting the things that you cannot really change. Why? Because sometimes we may feel like, all right, I can do that, and I can carry on this project, and I can also get involved into that kind of tasks, etc., etc. But afterwards, you find yourself trying to reach the goal that you haven't even structured, so you don't have it really detailed. And therefore, you're just running for something and you would never reach it. Why that is happening? One of the potential reasons may be that you're trying to be the best interpreter, the best translator, to get the best clients, to get yourself involved into the best projects, etc., etc. However, trying to be the best, it's a really self-destructive thing, because afterwards, there is no point where you would understand that you have become the best. You would always find things that you can criticize yourself about. That is why the best comparison that you can apply is comparing yourself to the former version of yourself. So trying to become better than you were yesterday, that is the best motivation ever. That would help you to be realistic about your own opportunities and resources. Also, see the opportunities once they come, because you would see that, okay, that is something I can do. So it would help me to get this knowledge or meet that kind of people or gain those skills. And yet you will not be trying to catch pretty much everything that lies there in the world. So to sum it up, please try to be more calm about this self the world attitude when you want to also help everybody else and once again become the best person ever, who is the most successful and the most supportive and the most caring colleague and the best mother and the most caring sister, etc. Okay. Trying to be less demanding towards yourself is also a very important issue. Okay, and the last, I believe, thing that I wanted to talk about today is the way we choose stress. Because believe it or not, but at some point, we are actually the ones who decide to feel stress. So we choose it ourselves. No matter if we do that deliberately or subconsciously. And that is a time when you can take a look at yourself and ask, why do I actually choose feeling stressed nowadays? The answers may not be, you know, as pleasant as you would want them to be. However, that understanding will be meaningful for you to deal with stress management and actually minimize it and feel more, you know, relieved, more emotionally stable, etc. So why people would choose stress anyway? They would choose it to really escape and avoid new tasks or, you know, avoid the responsibility. Perhaps you could face it, you've faced it already, or you could see it among your friends or relatives when something, you know, big is coming, a big event or a big project, etc. And then right before it's on, well, there are symptoms of being sick and the head aches and you cannot really do anything about it. And you just skip the whole story, right? So you just skip the whole thing. Well, it can be a coincidence, obviously, but most likely that your body just felt that, okay, something is wrong here. It's a potentially dangerous environment. So let's protect you and let's keep you away from it. And this is how you end up feeling stressed and but not actually get into something that can potentially be exciting and really opening up new opportunities for yourself. Sometimes we choose to feel stress if, surprisingly, we just want to get support from somebody. So to have the excuse for help or for getting appreciation or for getting support from our colleagues or teammates or family members or clients. Right, but in this case, it's just really meaningful and useful to understand that there is no need to feel bad in order to require support. It can be done just without actually being unresourceful. And another aspect can be that once again, you were trying to, let's say, avoid responsibility, and then you became stressed, and then at some point you managed to escape from a stressful situation and you stayed in your comfort zone. And with that in mind, your brain decided that it's a really helpful behavioral pattern. So why don't we actually use it in our daily life? And nowadays you just stick to this pattern, even though you wouldn't really want to do that. And there is no need for it anymore. So once again, dealing with our patterns with something that we are used to is another thing that you can analyze. I'm basically done with my part. I would just show the quotes from Viktor Frankl. I'm not sure if you're familiar with this man, but he's a psychologist, and briefly speaking, he has had a difficult life. So he's gone through a lot, and you can actually read some of his books where he describes that experience of his. But I believe it's really inspiring to support his opinion in that, everything can be taken, right? We do not really know what will happen tomorrow. Yet the only thing that we are of full control of is our freedom in choosing the way we are going to respond to the environment. So with that in mind, let me encourage you, hopefully, and say that you have resources to deal with stress. It's really up to you to take action and do something about it. And most likely, you will be able to minimize it until the very level that you feel appropriate.